how was crafting that idea into the short, This Means War?
Well, basically, Andrew, who I direct with, Andrew Kasch, he loves haunts, yard haunts. He goes to everyone in California. He just loves them every year. That's his favorite thing. I love them too, but he's nuts about it. So when Tales of Halloween began, and we were asked about our story, he very naturally wanted to do something about that. Then I had to think, who are the people who are fighting? Who are our main characters? And it immediately became clear that Boris, the old school guy, likes the classic horrors of the 1930s. He wants everything classy and elegant, and he does not like Dante across the street, his new neighbor, who is Rob Zombie intestines and just, you know, disgusting everything. And so these guys are like the cobra and the mongoose, you know, two animals who were born to hate each other, and that's a situation that is pretty much true in the horror scene, that many people who are traditionalists are not impressed with the gore style people, and the gory style people tend to think maybe the old school guys are kind of boring and out of date, and so this was a very natural thing. And then, but both of them really love Halloween, and mm-hmm. both of them really love the horror for their own reasons. So for them to hate each other is kind of crazy, but there you go, because we're kind of a crazy species. Mm-hmm. And that's why we told the story that we did with these two goofy guys, and of course it ends not well.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about the relationship with comedy and horror, two very primal reactions, right?
I feel like horror and humor are the different sides of the same coin, that both of them are involved with something going horribly wrong, but with humor, a guy slips on a banana peel and falls on his butt, and he goes, and everybody laughs. In horror, he slips on a banana peel, falls on his butt, he breaks his ass, and then something comes and eats him while he screams in pain. You know, same stupid thing happened, mm-hmm. very different ways of looking at it. Andrew and I are both, we both come at horror often from a humorous angle because it's funnier that way, and because I feel the more truth you tell, sometimes you need to take the sting out a little bit, mm-hmm. So that you can bite twice as hard, if that mm-hmm. makes sense.
Talking about the film, did you guys, the directors, did you guys coordinate? Did you kind of share what you were doing among each other? Because it feels like a, you know, unified effort in a way.
We had many, many meetings in which we talked about how the movie was going to go. Everybody sort of got to do their own movie, but coordinating with each other, like, for example, with This Means War, one of the things that happens is a big crowd forms to watch these guys go at it, and many of them are characters from the other shorts, mm-hmm. and that was just a cool way to bring it all together, you know, and yeah, ours in the middle, like it is, it's almost like Grand Central Station. You can see characters on their way to do the crazy thing at the end of the movie, or on their way from doing the crazy thing they did earlier in the movie, mm-hmm. And that's just kind of how we played it.
You have a long story with horror as a writer, especially with zombies. Are zombies your favorite? How do you see zombies treated now in popular culture?
Well, you know, it changed a lot. I'm almost 60 years old. I'm 58 years old. When I was a teenager, when I was 14 years old, I saw Night of the Living Dead for the first time in 1970, when it had just gone off the drive-in circuit and started to show in respectable theaters. And it marked me very, very strongly. Now, up until then, zombies were just either voodoo zombies mm-hmm. or hypnosis zombies, you know, spin the little thing and do what they tell you. They didn't get a lot of respect. But all of a sudden, when George Romero made it a situation where your next door neighbor or the person you love most could get up and eat you, that mm-hmm. changed everything. And it took a long time. I edited a book in 1989 called Book of the Dead. It was the first book of fiction about post-Romero zombies. And Stephen King wrote a story, and all these other great writers, Joe Lansdale, they all came in, and it was exciting because it had never been done. Mm-hmm. And I basically got the idea because I was on the phone with George Romero. He wanted to make a movie out of one of my books, The Light at the End. And I'm talking to one of my heroes, and all of a sudden I'm like, George, I've got this idea. What if we did a book in which all the great writers that I know write a zombie story set in your world? And he said, well, I don't think anybody would care. I don't think anybody would give a shit. But if you don't use any of my characters or scenes from my movies, then our producer won't sue you, and go ahead, and I'll eat my hat. He said, I will eat my hat if we do it. He says he ate a Pittsburgh Steelers cap with spaghetti sauce on it when we did mm-hmm. the book. So, so now I'm like a zombie authority. I know a lot. I was there pretty early on and helped, mm-hmm. you know.
But you also were very close with another great monster like Mr. Freddy Krueger.
Yes,
I'm
did.
Such a fan of Freddy, of the Nightmare on Elm Street movies. Tell me about the legacy of Freddy Krueger, Wes Craven, and can that be recreated today? Because they already tried, didn't work that well. They're talking about a remake.
Well, here's the thing. Wes Craven made a really good movie called Nightmare on Elm Street with a really great villain named Freddy Krueger. And of course, because it made a lot of money, they had to do many, many sequels. Mm-hmm. Some of them are very good. Some of them are very bad. The one that I was involved with, very bad. And had a very bad experience with it. That doesn't mean I don't love Freddy Krueger. It just means that they made a bad movie out of a story that, let's put it this way, we wrote the original script. 6 writers and 13 drafts later, they had the movie that they wanted, which had one line of our dialogue left. And we had to threaten them with legal action to get our names on it. So that's how that went. But as to your big question, could it be done again? If somebody makes up an original monster as interesting as Freddy Krueger, yes. The second somebody does that, then there will be a million sequels of that, and some of them will be good and some of them will be bad. But I think the job of filmmakers right now is to try and come up with the new ones, mm-hmm. so that we don't have to keep doing the same ones we've been doing since the 80s or go all the way back to the 30s to Frankenstein. You know, we need some new monsters. Mm-hmm. I guess that's all I'm saying.
Last question. What's going to be your Halloween costume this year?
Oh, I'm not going to wear one this year. I'm going to watch my grandchildren wear them. I loved costuming all my life. Then when my children got old enough to trick-or-treat, that was my favorite thing. And I would dress up to trick-or-treat with them. Once they got too old for that, I was like, And then now I have grandchildren, and they're getting dressed up. Yeah, my grandson is, I believe, doing Jack from Nightmare Before Christmas. Mm-hmm. And I just saw a picture of him today in his costume, seeing himself in a mask for the first time. He's like 3 years old and he's seeing himself in the mask and he's like, hey, I don't look bad. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to be dressed as a smiling grandparent.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.